is in the atmosphere for around 100 years. Now, if the relative global warming potential of carbon dioxide is 1, methane is 25 times more stronger. Nitrous oxide is around 300 times more, having more intense effect on our environment. But fluorocarbons, it can affect up to 12,000 times more than the carbon dioxide. Hydrofluorocarbons are also of a similar range, that is around 14,000 times they are more stronger than the carbon dioxide. Sulfur hexafluoride also affects the environment, the warming potential, up to 22,000 times as compared to carbon dioxide. Now, all these greenhouse gases, they are retained in the environment over different spans of time. Water vapors, generally the retention period is around 9 days. But when we talk of other gases, that is carbon dioxide, it remains in our environment for 100 years before leaving the atmosphere. Methane, the time is 12 years. Nitrous oxide remains in the atmosphere for 120 years. And halocarbons, depending upon the type of the chemical, they are in our atmosphere from several weeks up to 50,000 years. Now, all these greenhouse gases, they create the green global warming. That is due to the greenhouse effect. What happens is, these greenhouse gases, they create a layer in the atmosphere over our Earth. Whenever the solar radiation, which is shortwave radiation, it passes through this layer of gases, whenever it strikes the Earth, since it is solid, now these are converted into long wave radiation, generally long wave radiations. Now these long wave radiation, they are trapped inside the atmosphere, because when they strike the greenhouse gases, what they do is they either absorb and reflect these infrared or long wave radiation in the same wavelength, so that again these heat waves re-enter our atmosphere over the surface of our Earth. Thereby, it increases the temperature on the surface of our Earth. And because of this, during the last 100 years, the Earth warmed up by around 1 degree Celsius. Now, if these greenhouse gases are not there, say, like carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, nitrous oxide, and so on in the atmosphere, our Earth will have the temperature of 0 degree Fahrenheit. But these, because of the presence of these gases, the atmosphere is being warmed up. But since the emission of these gases are increasing, and at such a higher rate, that they are creating undesirable effect in the atmosphere. Now, due to these rise in temperature, we are having environmental degradation. Acid rain formation is there, because these gases, whenever the rain falls, they mixes up in the rain, and the acid rain phenomena occurs. And because of this, we have several environmental problems, like we have reduction in the crop yield, and it also affects our buildings. Like you see, there is a drive going on, like cleaning of Taj Mahal, and even it pollutes our streams and agricultural fields also. And when we talk of energy, one of the important aspects with related to technology or our requirements, still we see 17% of the world population do not have access to electricity. That is around 235 million people. And in India, around 22% of which is over the world's population, we have 270 million people in our country without the access of electricity. And still 840 million people in our country, they cook their meals by biomass, and thereby creating smoke and pollution. Now, in the past 100 years, the carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere has increased by 25%, which is quite alarming. Global consumption of fresh water is also increasing because of industrialization, because of increase in population. It is almost doubling every 20 years. The Earth's forest freshwater and marine environments has been reduced because of pollution by around 30% in the last 30 years. Now, due to all these adverse climatic conditions, what is happening is we are seeing rising in the sea levels, increasing frequency of severe storms, droughts, heat waves and hurricanes, as you have seen in the past years, that we are having floods in the Rajasthan, while the places like Chirapunji, which was known as the place where we had the highest rainfall, the amount of rain now it receives is receding. And tsunami and all these effects, these are the cause because of the pollution. Then retreating of glaciers and ice caps. The Gangotri glacier, it has been found, is receding at the rate of 25 kilometers per year. So thereby, our rivers are having lesser amount of water as compared to earlier days. Then contaminated water supply is there. Altered crop pattern is there because of the different climatic conditions. It is changing. Then we are suffering from desertification and famine because of the change in the pattern of rainfall also. And because of the climatic condition, that is increased diseases are a common occurrence these days. As you might be reading the newspapers lately, that we have a lot of cases of malaria, dengue and chikungunya. So that is because of the change in the environmental condition. We are having more humid and more high temperature now during this span of year, and these conditions are very good for the mosquitoes and other such type of insects. So that is why it is very much important that we should arrest our environmental pollution. You see, around 5 lakh people, because of this change in the environmental conditions and global warming, there are around more than 5 lakh people die every year in the developing countries. Now, when we see the energy scenario of our country, we have 2.4% of the world's total annual energy production, but we consume about 3.3% of the world's total energy. It means our consumption is higher as compared to the energy production at our country. So we import a lot of energy in the form of oil and other fossil fuel resources. And even our coal is also not of a good quality. So that is why we also import coal also to generate the power. And when we see the greenhouse gas emission, so in the year 2007, it was around more than 1700 metric ton of carbon dioxide. And as per census 2011, we have the people who reside in the villages of the order of 68%, and 31% is the persons living in the cities. And this trend is going to increase. That is, more urbanization is taking place. With time, it is predicted that urban population and cities will increase as compared to the villages. Now, almost 59% of the people of our country, they use fuel wood for cooking, and thereby they use the time which can be used for other productive activities to gather wood and other biomass. Another problem is the emission of smoke when we use the biomass for cooking food, and thereby the health problems also are existing a lot. And when we see the electricity, only 55% of the rural areas have access to electricity, and around 93% of the urban areas have electricity. Still, we have 382 million of our rural population without the access to electricity. And LPG accessibility in the rural areas is just 15.5%. And if we talk about in numbers, we have 34,884 villages which are without electricity as per Government of India records in the year 2012. Our per capita energy consumption is 6,400 kilowatt hour, And we have a shortage of energy at the order of 9%, and peak shortage is about 10.6%. We are mainly using fossil fuels to generate energy and thereby polluting our environment. The installed capacity of for electricity in our country is around, it is 2,29,000 and around 260 megawatt, and around 60% of this energy is generated through coal and gas and diesel. More than 60%, it is around 70%. So while hydro, it is just around 17%, and renewable energy is now around 13% through which we generate our power. You see, in the present condition, we import 75% of our oil and only 2% of the coal to meet our requirement. And we have energy intensity of 3.7 times of Japan, 1.55 times of USA, and 1.5 times the world average. Now, this energy intensity means that for production of per unit of some product, how much time the energy we are consuming. It means we are inefficient when we see our technology, when we utilize energy for getting the useful output from it. The ratio for the developed country is less than one with regard to the energy intensity, and high energy intensity points to energy wastage in the economy. On an average, the Indian power plants, they uses India's coal supply of about 0.7 kg to generate 1 kilowatt hour. Whereas the developed country like United States, the thermal power plants, they consume around 0.45 kg of coal for generating per kilowatt hour. So this shows our scope for further improvement of technologies. Now, when we talk about environment, the pollution, the air pollution, it accounts for 1.3 million deaths annually and 4.3 million deaths globally from indoor air pollution. From outdoor air pollution, there are around 9.4 lakh deaths worldwide. Now, this is a severe cause of death in India. Of the world's top 20 polluted cities, 13 are in India. And because of this air pollution, our life expectancy is reduced by 3.2 years. Like in one of the city, that is Delhi. So we, because of all these adverse effects, we need to halve the carbon dioxide emission by 2050. And thereby, we have to use clean technologies and clean energy sources. So we require increasing energy efficiency in industry, vehicles and appliances, accelerating the transformation of its power sector, promoting adoption of green and clean technologies, and establishing sustainable agriculture and forestry practices. Now, what is clean technology? It is defined as environmentally friendly, developed and used in such a way so that it doesn't disturb our environment and conserves the natural resources. The main objective is to find ways to create new technologies in such a way that they do not damage or deplete the planet's natural resources. Now, the main usage of the clean technologies is intended to mitigate or reverse the effect of human activity on the environment due to the pollution. And these inventions are environmentally friendly, which involve energy efficiency, recycling, safety and health concerns, renewable energy, and reuse, etc. And these clean technologies are very much required for sustainable development. That is, meeting the today's demand without adversely affecting the resources so that future generation can meet their demands with the resources, natural resources available on our earth. Now, this, the opportunities available and the requirements with regard to requirements of clean technologies has been analyzed and presented in the World Bank Group report in the year 2014. And the major highlights of this report are that there is a lot of scope, that is, there is a lot of work to be done in the area to generate significant growth and create jobs by capturing $1.6 trillion market in green and clean technologies. In 2011-12, this sector was a $5.5 trillion global market, and it is forecast to grow at about 4.1% annually, faster, which is much faster than the rate by which our global economy is increasing. Investment across 15 clean technology sectors in 145 developing countries is expected to top with $6.4 trillion over the next decades, with $1.6 trillion of that market accessible, which is accessible to small and medium enterprises. The important areas in which there is a scope for working is wastewater treatment facilities, which represents over 1/3 of the total likely clean technology investment in developing countries, which includes water treatment, onshore wind power, solar PV, small hydro, and waste management. The leading opportunities for the Indian scenario is onshore wind, solar PV, and wastewater. India's installed wind capacity is forecast to approach 60 gigawatt by 2020. And the country also plans to deploy up to 22 gigawatt of solar power by 2022 as a part of its national solar mission under Ministry of New and Renewable Energy of India. Now, even the government programs are aiming to accelerate the deployment of services in these sectors, that is water supply, wastewater treatment, water management, and solid waste management. One of the example is Natsol Water Solution Private. It is an Indian small and micro entrepreneurship which comes under this. It was established in 2006, and it is working across water and wastewater sector, which offers reverse osmosis system, effluent treatment plants, and sewage treatment plants. So such type of opportunities have a positive effect on the environment and community. Some of the clean and renewable, very important resources with respect to renewable energy technologies are solar photovoltaic, concentrating solar power, solar thermal energy, bioenergy, that is energy from the biomass, small hydro, onshore wind. You see, there is onshore and offshore wind. Onshore wind means that we have wind turbines installed on the land, while offshore wind is when we install wind turbines on the sea. Then biofuels. Now, these solar energy technologies, since India has around 300 years of clear sunny day, so we have got a lot of potential to use this solar energy to meet our energy demands. We can use this solar energy by two ways. One is thermal, that is getting the heat energy from the sun and utilizing it for meeting our various type of requirements in the way of heating water, like solar water heater, cooking food through solar cooker, drying of agriculture produce by using solar dryer, then solar concentrating power plant to generate power, and solar still to generate distilled water, etc. Another way through which the solar energy technologies are being used, that is by using the light or photons which are available in the solar energy to create power. Then this solar, through this methodology, we can generate power. We can use it for lighting purpose through solar PV lanterns or solar PV light or street light. And this can also be used for pumping water. Solar thermal, as I have discussed, it describes the technologies that use the heat of the sun for heating purpose or for producing electricity. Generally, these type of systems, they use flat plate collectors to capture heat from the sun, and like in the solar water heating system. While in the solar thermal electric power plants, we use concentrating devices to focus the sunlight and achieve the higher temperatures to produce steam from power. So this shows a solar water heating system, which consists of absorber sheets which are blackened, and there are pipelines to transport the water. We have a glass cover on it so that to trap the heat inside inside the absorber, and the pipes are all insulated, thermally insulated, so that heat is not lost in the atmosphere. Another type of solar water heaters available are of evacuated tube type. So these are made up of double layer borosilicate glass tubes which are evacuated for providing insulation. The outer wall of the inner tube is coated with a selective absorbing material for absorbing of solar radiation, and this transfers the heat to the water which flows to the inner tube. Now these type of solar water heaters, that is evacuated tube type, are less costlier as compared to flat plate collector, and they can safely handle the hard water also. A 100 liter capacity of solar water heating system can save around 4 to 6 units of electricity per day for residential use, and saves around 1500 units of electricity annually with 300 clear days. And this also helps our environment, because it prevents emission of 1.5 tons of carbon dioxide per year. Another clean technology is the dish type of solar cooker. This generally is made up of reflecting material, that is anodized aluminium sheet. It is hemispherical in shape with aperture diameter of 1.4 meter and focal length is 0.28 meter. The temperature achieved in this solar cooker is around 400 degrees Celsius, which is sufficient for roasting, frying and boiling. It can boil around 2 to 3 liters of water in half an hour and saves 10 LPG cylinders in a year. The thing required is that tracking of solar cooker is required, which is manually, and it has to be adjusted after around 15 to 20 minutes depending upon the position of the sun. Another type of solar cooker is box type, where we can boil, bake and roast, but we cannot use it for frying. As the temperature is lesser, it is around 150 degrees Celsius as compared to the dish type of solar cooker. Another type of system is solar steam cooking system, where we have elliptically shaped parabolic solar concentrators which are arranged in parallel modules, and they are aligned in the east-west directions. And there are the receivers which are placed on the focus of these dishes. These are highly quality glass mirrors with reflectivity of 90%. It has 16 meters square of surface area. These are known as Scheffler dishes, and they have automatic sun tracking mechanism. So what happens is there is a working fluid, that is water, which is, as you can see, there are pipes, insulated pipes in which it flows, and these Scheffler dishes, it concentrates the solar radiation on these pipes, thereby converting into steam. And we get the temperature of around 150 to 260 degrees Celsius. Now this steam is passed through the enclosure, which is in which we have cooking cylinder, and this can give us enough energy for cooking for 3 to 4 dishes, which are of the size of 16 square meter each, and sufficient for cooking food for around 250 to 300 people. It can also be used for boiling the feed water, preheating, and washing in laundries. And also oil heating for cooking or industrial application, and milk pasteurization. Another usage of clean technology is for distillation of water, that is through solar still. So here what happens is we have the solar energy, and this solar energy is used to heat water, thereby it evaporates, and when it evaporates, then it is condensed and thereby collected in the container. So we have around 2.5 to 3 liters of distilled water per square meter in a day. This distilled water can be used in our chemical laboratories or dispensaries for sterilization or hospitals, and also for garages and automobile workshops. Another application is the agriculture for crop drying. Here, the food processing industries, they generally use it, the solar dryer, for rehydration of fruits and other vegetables like potatoes and onions. Even the dairy products industry for the production of milk powder can use such type of dryer. It can be used for seasoning of wood and timber also, and in the textile industries for drying of textile materials. So this shows the picture that how that is a working principle. Now what happens, there is an enclosure and which is painted in the dull black color from inside, and there are holes on the one on the inner side, on the lower side of one side of the our solar dryer, and on the other side we have holes on the upper side. So due to convection flow of the air currents inside this enclosure, what happens is the heat is generated, and through this heat the water present in our grains, it gets evaporated, and which flows out through the holes on the upper side of the enclosure as shown in the diagram through the arrows. So thereby drying the product in the lesser time and giving us hygienic food. So this is another type of dryer. Here we have an air dryer which is attached to the dryer, which is used for drying the agriculture produce in a different chamber. So air flows through the air dryer, air gets heated up, and then this heated air flows through the grains, thereby drying it. Now another application of solar energy is photovoltaic energy. It is conversion of sunlight into electricity through a photovoltaic cells, which are called solar cells, and they are made of silicon materials. These cells can be connected in series parallel connection depending on the power output required. Each cell generally generates around 0.4 volts, and 36 cells are usually soldered together in series to produce a module which can charge a battery of 12 volt. A solar cell produces around 25 to 30 milliampere per centimeter square of a current. Usually 1 square feet of solar PV module gives an output of 10 to 12 watts peak. One of the application of this type of technology is for home lighting. Here we have battery and a solar module. So solar module charges up the battery during the day, and this battery can be used to run to light up our lamp during the night. Another application is that the power generated by solar cell can be used for pumping the centrifugal monoblock pump set for lifting water. So this generally delivers 65,000 of liter per day of water from a suction head of 7 meters or a total head of 10 meters. And this panel required is of 900 watts. Another application is a solar street light. This solar energy can also be used to generate the power. Here what happens is we have the sort of solar photovoltaic module, and which is which can be fed to the grid for the grid interactive type of solar power plant, or through the, because what happens is this our solar PV power is generated in the DC mode, so that it has to be, so we have to use inverter to convert it into AC supply, and then it is connected to the grid. And another system is we have a battery bank or standalone type of solar the PV power system, in which the solar energy, that is DC solar energy, it is stored in the battery, and then it is through inverter, it is then given to the our various appliances. Then in our institute also we have 50 kilowatt peak of power plant or grid interactive, and we also have another power plant which has been recently installed, that is 20 kilowatt of grid interactive, and 20 kilowatt is standalone and 15 kilowatt is grid interactive. Now another type of application for generating power through sun is using of concentrating solar power plants. It chooses lenses or mirrors to focus the large amount of sunlight into a small concentrating beam, and then it can this heat can be used as a heat source like in the conventional power plant. Here we use parabolic reflectors or concentrating linear Fresnel reflectors. So this picture shows the parabolic trough-shaped mirrors which focus the light on the tube running down the focal line. Light is absorbed in the tube, in a glass vacuum tube, and carried away by the heat transfer fluid. Another is solar concentrator. Yet another technology is the dish type of solar concentrators. Now, another source of clean energy is biomass. It is an organic matter which is produced by plants and its derivatives. It includes forest crops, residues, crops, and animal manures. Now, why it is renewable? Because plant life renews and adds to itself every year. Biomass potential in our country is more than 19,000 megawatt. We can use this biomass to useful energy through thermal conversion and through biochemical conversion. Thermal conversion involves direct combustion, gasification, or through pyrolysis. In the biochemical conversion, we can have anaerobic digestion or fermentation. The technologies involved are briquetting and torrefaction. In the briquetting, it is the process of compacting loose biomass into uniform dense forms, which are having the less moisture content. Such type of biomass is used, like stalks, husks, straw, pits, seeds, and sawdust. Torrefaction is another process in which pellets are produced through high temperature oxygen removal process, similar to making charcoal. In the biochemical process, what happens is bacteria breaks down the biomass in the absence of air, and methane is produced, which can be used as a fuel and or for generation of power. The biofuel is another application of biomass. These are generally derived from sugarcane, maize, beets, and other starchy crops. Here, bacteria, yeast, and enzymes are added to the biomass liquids, causes biomass materials to ferment and change into alcohol. And similar process is used to turn agricultural products into ethanol, which is then mixed with gasoline to make an ethanol gasoline blend. In the another application of biomass is the gasification through thermal chemical conversion. Here the biomass is heated with limited oxygen to produce low heating value gas known as producer gas. And in the biochemical conversion, that is in the which is generally being done through biogas plants, we have anaerobic digestion and fermentation, microbial digestion of biomass at low temperature with high moisture content of 80%, which generates a gas which is generally known as biogas, with methane of around 55 to 65%, and carbon dioxide is 30 to 40%. So this picture shows the biomass gasifiers. It is a reactor which converts biomass into clean gaseous fuel by heating the biomass in limited oxygen, where the solid biomass breaks down to form the gas called producer gas, which consists of carbon monoxide, hydrogen, carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrogen. This gas has calorific value of 1000 to 1200 kilocalories per cubic meter. This producer gas is fed into the diesel engine to let the engine operate in the dual fuel mode, thereby reducing the diesel consumption by more than 70%. This gas can also be burned directly in the furnace to generate process heat. So that is why this is being used successfully in industries also. And generally, the product, the biomass which is used is firewood, coconut shell, corn flour, stem, sawdust, rice husk, cotton stock, etc. Using gasifier, 1 liter of oil can be saved through use of either 4 kg of wood or up to 5 kg of rice. Approximately around 1.5 kg of wood produces 1 kilowatt hour of power through gasifier. And they are used in textile mills, dyeing and processing units, foundries, tea factories, coal industries, rice mills, etc. They are also being used for electrification of rural and remote areas and for irrigation pumping. Biogas, what happens is, it is produced by breakdown of organic matter in the absence of oxygen and presence of moisture. Now we have a largest population of animals in our country, in the world, and thereby we have large animal waste also at our disposal, for which can be used for generating the biogas. This biogas plant, it is an enclosure in which we put the cow dung and equal quantity of water, and we let it ferment for say 30 to 40 days depending upon the climatic condition of a particular area. That what happens is, due to the digestion, microbes working on this waste, bio waste, this is converted into gas, and also the digested part is known as slurry, which is very good, and it can be in micronutrients, rich in micronutrients and other nutrients, for and can be used as a fertilizer for manuring of crops. This biogas is about 20% lighter than air. It has ignition temperature in the range of 650 degrees to 750 degrees Celsius. It is odorless and colorless gas that burns with a clear blue flame, which is similar to that of LPG gas. And its calorific value is 20 megajoules per cubic meter. It burns with 60% efficiency in the conventional biogas stove. And when we see the digestive slurry, its nutrient as compared to farmyard manure, it almost has the double the value. That is nitrogen, phosphorus and potash. So it is more nutrient as compared to farmyard manure for manuring our crops. Generally, we have two types of biogas plant. One is KVIC type, that is through Khadi Village Industry Commission. And another is Deen Bandhu type, and it is build up of masonry structure. KVIC is having a higher investment as compared to Deen Bandhu type of biogas plant, which is hemispherically being made, as you can see in the picture, and it requires skilled manpower to make it. Now, 1 cubic meter of biogas is equivalent to 0.52 liters of diesel, 0.62 liters of kerosene, and 3.50 kg of wood, and 0.43 kg of LPG. This biogas can be used for various purposes, like for cooking, for which for per person per day we required 0.24 cubic meter per day, for lighting of the lamp, for running the dual fuel engine, where we require around 0.50 cubic meter per hour, and for generating of electricity also. For 1 kilowatt hour, that is 1 unit generation of electricity, we require 0.50 cubic meter per hour of the biogas. This is one of the example of using the bio waste, that is cow dung, to generate electricity. That is biomethanation power plant, which has been installed in Ludhiana. Now, another clean energy source is the mini hydropower. Generally, the plants up to 1 megawatt capacities come under this. The advantages of installing the mini hydro plant is that we do not have any deforestation or submergence. It has a short gestation period. We don't have any resettlement problems. It eliminates the long transmission systems, and it is very much suitable for remote and hilly areas. And it can be installed with at heads below 3 meters and with the water discharges from 55 to 80 cubic meter per second. We have a large potential in India for the small hydropower, which is around 15,000 megawatts. Another application of the clean energy is through usage of wind energy. It results from, as we know that wind results from the differential heating of the land and its atmosphere by the sun, and it can be converted into mechanical or electrical energy. And India's wind potential is 45,000 megawatt. India ranks 5th in the world for using the wind power. We have now wind turbines which are available from 250 kilowatt to up to even 5 megawatt system today. And the rate of power generation depends upon the air density, direction of wind, wind speed and so on. When we see the contribution from these energy sources, it is quite less as compared to the installed capacity. When we see the installed capacity, it is quite less as compared to the potential available in our country. This is the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy Status Report of 2016, which shows the progress of utilization of various clean energy sources in our country with respect to their potential. Like wind energy, we have installed capacity of around 27,000 megawatt. There is but this is around 26%. Solar energy, we have just exploited around 4% or so. Small hydropower is around 22%. Biopower is 26%, that is gasification, biomass and biogastric cogeneration. And waste to energy conversion is around 3%. So we still have a lot of potential to further use our clean energy sources in our country. Even Government of India has also taken initiatives to promote clean and green energy. There are central and state electricity regulatory commissions which have taken the initiative to promote the renewable energy by specifying minimum renewable energy procurement obligation as per Electricity Act 2003 and other policies. The states have adopted preferential tariff mechanisms to promote renewable energy and provides differential tariffs for the development of different renewable energy technologies. And as I have already discussed, we have National Solar Mission also, under which we target of 20,000 megawatt solar power generation in the coming years. Another clean technology relates to wastewater and sanitation. Now, we know, as has been discussed by our speakers before, that we do not have safe drinking water accessibility. Still 700 million of people are without the access of safe drinking water. Only 25% of the total population in India has drinking water in their premises, and the women are the biggest sufferers in this. And only 27% of the India's wastewater is being treated, and remainder is just flowing and thrown into the rivers, canals and groundwater or to the sea. So we require to take certain measures and arrest all these pollutions. The options which are technological options available are water conservation through rainwater harvesting, which was discussed by our speaker yesterday. Then we have to be economically and optimally using the water through crop diversification, sprinkler irrigation, drip irrigation, and using of the crops appropriate to the rainfall patterns of a given region. Reuse and recycling, that is recycling of treated wastewater for gardening, industrial cooling, street cleaning, irrigation, etc. Drip irrigation, grey water. Another thing is that the water that is which comes from our sinks, showers, baths, or clothes, washing machine, or dishwashers, it contains lesser pathogens than the domestic wastewater. So it is safer to handle and easier to treat and reuse for on-site toilet flushing, landscape, or irrigation and other non-potable uses. In Chandigarh also, such type grey water is supplied for this watering of lawns or in the parks or for fountains, etc. This is the how it shows the usage of the grey water for various purposes. This is another technology where the water is not being wasted. Our grey water, it is directly used in the flush for flushing. Now, when we see our waste, then you see municipal solid waste in our country. In the last 10 years, it has doubled from 34 million tons per year to 68 million tons per year. So this is also a big area of concern, how to manage this waste. One of the solutions is organic waste management is composting. Now, organic waste is that can be decomposed easily, and it is generally made from the organic matter, like wastage of our vegetables, fruits, etc. So we can compost it, and it will be converted into degradable organic waste, and which can be used for manure. Another thing is we can use earthworms through vermicomposting technology to convert this waste into nutrient-rich manure for supplying nutrients to help the plant growth. And some of the species used for generating of the vermicompost are Yersinia fritidia, Lumbricus rebellus, Apis andrajus. There are around 300,000 or so species available of the earthworms, but few are suitable for generation of the vermicompost. Quite easy process. Now, we just can put our cow dung and we can mix it with our organic waste, and then we can leave the earthworms on the bed. And after, say, two to three months, automatically we will have the vermicompost. And when we use it on the organic waste, then they consume organic waste, these earthworms, and they reduce its volume by 40 to 60%, and they produces cast equal to 50% of the waste it consumes in a day. Just we have to be careful of the certain conditions that they should be well aerated bedding with, and moisture also content should be high when we use this technology, and the earthworm population automatically doubles in around 2 to 3 months, and then this technology can further be multiplied. Then waste recycling is another opportunity to manage our environment and use it for the for our daily requirement, like recycled paper can be used for making our this covers for the we have the file covers and all. Similarly, ash it can be used for bricks, and some of the waste sand and fibers can be used for carpet making and so on. Now even the organic catering industry is coming these days. Here what happens is we use plastic, avoid use plastic and paper goods as much as possible. We have nowadays even edible cutlery. There is a website www.bakeys.com, one of the example is there, where we have the edible cutlery. After taking the meals, this cutlery can be eaten, so no wastage is being created. And even organic products are also being used for making soaps, cosmetics and this thing, and other cleaning products, which is very much required in today's world, and another products for the beautification also. Then green building, it has already been discussed, it is the need of the hour, so that we minimize the demand for water, electricity and other natural resources in a building, and we generate the electricity on site through renewable means. Even the food is also grown on the site, and the recycling and reuse of its waste is being done. We have the code, different code, like energy conservation building code to promote. We have Bureau of Energy Efficiency to promote the energy conservation in the building. We have a LEED rating also for this green building. We have GRIHA, that is green rating for integrated habitat assessment, for promoting green construction. Then we can use eco-friendly materials, as already been discussed, like through waste reusage, fly ash bricks, bamboo and clay roofing tiles, and avoiding volatile organic compounds. Then we should use automated sensor based lights and even LED based lights. That is environmental friendly, that is green technology also, and they consume very less power as compared to our incandescent lamp. And we can switch over to electric vehicles in the coming days, or maybe we can travel through the bus or other vehicles rather than taking the individual vehicle, which can also reduce the pollution. Then food storage is also a very important aspect with regard to sustainable development and clean technologies. You see, in our country, 1/3 of the food is lost because of the inefficient and lesser number of storage and ineffective processing and logistics. Inadequate storage, it contributes to the world's insecurities. And for this, we can use silos with prevention of water intrusion. You see, this is very important in the light that 795 million people worldwide do not have enough food to eat. And in India, we have around 195 million people which are undernourished, and accounts for the highest number of people suffering from hunger in any single country. So the option, the technological option available is storing the grain in grain storage silo system properly. Another thing is that we should not waste anything. We should not be waste even in our energy. And that is why energy audit is being carried out, so that to assess the energy is the usage through various processes in an industry or in the home, and to see what are the energy saving opportunities, and thereby recommend the strategies or technologies for saving the energy consumption. Energy saving potential is in the agriculture sector up to 30%, in industrial up to 25%, in transport and domestic the potential is 20% each. And for this, even in our country has enacted in Energy Conservation Act and National Mission of enhanced energy energy efficiency under Bureau of Energy Efficiency, Ministry of Power, where energy conservation and energy efficiency is being promoted. And there is a special scheme for industry like PAT, that is Perform, Achieve and Trade, in which they have the directions are there that the energy conservation, energy consumption in the major energy guzzler industry, it has to be reduced, and targets have been set to that, to these industry to reduce their energy consumption. Here the some of the designated customers, they are the industries pertaining to aluminium, cement, chloralkali, fertilizer, pulp and paper, power, iron and steel, textiles. And this is how the they are issued the certificates, which is against the target which have been assigned to them. And if they save lesser amount of the energy, then they have to purchase the energy saving certificate or have to pay the penalty. So major, some of the energy conservation measures which can be adopted to save energies using the air compressor system modifications, installation of variable frequency drive, minimization of air leakage in plant, using energy efficient lighting like using LEDs, and we should choose natural light as much as possible in our home and as well as in our industry, and we should use good power factor appliances, and these are so and so on. So these were some of the clean technologies and clean energy with regard to the sustainable development. Thank you so much. Now the we are open for question answer session.
Ambient
University, Palwal. Okay, thank you. Next, from Bharatpur, Sri Gokul Verma Government Polytechnic College. Yes, please.
Thank you, ma'am. No questions.
Okay. Now we'll move to Shri Krishna Institute of Engineering and Technology, Kurukshetra. Any questions?
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Ma'am, can we use bamboo as a reinforcing material in concrete? Can we use bamboo as a reinforcing material in concrete?
Okay, since I am from the electrical side, I think yesterday the person came now who talked about this, like the bamboo usage or the green building first thing, civil engineering, from the civil engineering and architect side. Maybe we have the another session that is on which our experts from the civil engineering department will be coming, so they will be able to answer you this question in a more precise way. Since I'm from the electrical side, I don't know the technologies with regard to this. So please keep the question ready for them. They will be able to answer your question. Any other question, please? So thank you so much. And we'll meet after 15 minutes for the next session on watershed management. Any question from our participants?
Solar online.
So around 3 to 4 hours for 3 days.
Thank you.
Institute of Science?
I'm not changing, yeah.
Okay.
It's a new name now.
So, good morning everyone. Welcome back to the second session today. This session is on watershed management, which is very much required for the sustainable development for conservation of our natural resources, mainly soil and water. And so, throwing the light on this topic, we have an eminent expert, Dr. A.K. Tiwari, who is working as head in Indian Institute of Soil and Water Conservation, Chandigarh. Earlier, it was known as Central Soil and Water Conservation Research and Training Institute. So, we welcome you all, and we welcome you, sir. And Dr. Tiwari, he is basically from the agricultural background, and he, after that, he has after his graduation, he has done his M.Tech from IIT Kharagpur in the area of water and soil management, and thereafter, he has done his PhD in the area of hydrology from IIT Roorkee. He has done postdoc also from USA, from University of Georgia. And during the past more than 35 years, he has been intensely involved in the various projects and activities related to watershed management. And he is international expert also in this particular area. And the work which has been done by their organization under his leadership has been visited, that is the watershed has been visited by various eminent personalities like Sonia Gandhi, Mehendra Gandhi, various political leaders, as well as the international experts from across the world. So it is a live example they have done, the work in the Sukho Majri and other in village Bunga, is there?
Bunga
and other, and so many other, Rail Majra and so many other sites also. And the work which has been done is really an eye-opening experience, and I am sure that his talk will also give you a deep insight regarding the various aspects related to watershed management. What is the importance of it? What are the strategies to conserve our soil and water, a very important natural resources, and how the practically they have carried out this work, which has set an example across the world. So I'll request him to kindly highlight the watershed management and with regard to the integrated natural resource management and sustainable development.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Siya. As for the topic, role of watershed management programs in the integrated natural resource management in the sustainable development. Now here actually I'm just depicting the experience of the Shivalik region, where actually I'm working for last 10 years in this region. So actually I'm just going with that only. Now if you just go for the brief introduction, I think India has 16% of the world population, but merely 2.5% of the world geographical area. But a lot of area is lying under degradation. And if you just see the table, I think the first one, the water erosion, it constitutes the major portion of the region being for the degraded lands. And mostly, I think this kind of problem we face more where we have got more slope and all. Now, if you just look into the Shivalik region, it's about say 3 million hectare land. Now, this is actually spread over Himachal Pradesh, Jammu and Kashmir, Punjab, Haryana, Uttarakhand, and Chandigarh. Now, most of this area actually, if you just see, the elevation ranges from 250 meter to about 1600 meter. So, beyond that, actually, it becomes a middle Himalayas and the upper Himalayas. And if you look into the problems of the Shivalik region, it's a hilly terrain broken up with these steep slopes. That is the problem, main problem, which is causing the erosion. Wherever they have the excess rainfall, a lot of erosion is being occurred in that area. So that way, the Shivaliks have excessive erosion in this region. Now, whatever soil actually being eroded from the top actually hilly area, now it's all coming to the, maybe to the small pond, then to the rivers, then to the actually reservoirs, and likewise. As you all know, in Shivalik region, there are many major dams, like even Bhatanangal, even Thien Dam, Pong Dam, Pando and other, many others. So there actually also a lot of siltation is being caused. So this also becomes a very acute problem of the erosion in this area. And ultimately, we are going to lose the life of the dams. And that's going to cause major problem. Because the dams actually, they are providing lots of actually canal water. And apart from that, the electricity also, which is being supplied to 4 to 5 states. Then, certainly, I think erratic rainfall pattern This I think is problem we are having actually in most of the areas, maybe in other parts of the country also. So same problem we have here also. And as per the climate change, yes, again we are going to face a lot of problems. Because when we look into the say rainfall, the rainfall may be almost I think same which is happening in the last few years in the Shivalik region. It's around say more than 1,000 millimeter. But the problem is that nowadays the number of rainy days have gone down. So ultimately the rainfall intensity are becoming very higher. And when the high rainfall intensity is there, it's causing a lot of problem. It may be a problem of the erosion, it may be a problem of the floods and other problems like landslide and all in the hilly region. Now again actually in this because this region is having the uneven topography. So ultimately there is no possibility of the canal irrigation. Now again the groundwater is also beyond economical exploitable limits. So ultimately we rush into that whatever rain water is there, because that's a very good source for this region. If the rainfall is more than 1,000 millimeter, certainly I think this may cause more of the erosion. But again I think this maybe which is becoming a curse for this region can be again utilized for the benefit also. And that way actually if you go for the water harvesting in this region, I think that is the major solution where actually we can collect the water, we can I think irrigate our fields, and that can become only the major source of irrigation, particularly in the Shivalik region. Now again this torrential erosion, this is another problem in this Shivalik foothills particularly, because when the water is coming from the hilly region, it comes with a very high velocity due to high slopes. But whenever it comes down, the slope of the actually channel actually is not that much, and ultimately water spreads over both the sides, spoiling the agriculture fields, spreading the debris over the fields, and actually that way our fertile soil actually being suppressed, and that is being actually taken over by the debris and all, and causing the actually loss in the crop yields. Now again actually in this hilly region, a low agriculture income due to small land holdings and inferred agriculture, and again heavy biotic pressure. Now a lot of road construction there, mining is there, deforestation is being taking place for the last many years, and again the cattle pressure also. So there are some of the problems in the actually Shivalik region. Now here I think you can just see some of the soil erosion maps of the Himachal Pradesh, Punjab and Haryana. I've shown you these three maps because the upper portion of the say Punjab on the right hand side, it belongs to actually the Shivalik region. Similarly in the case of the Haryana, if you just see that the top portion which having a slightly red mark also, that is again the Shivalik region, red in the say light yellow also. And then actually on the top you can see that this is the Himachal Pradesh, and lots of area is lying under the Shivalik region, beyond which I think we have the Middle Himalayas and the Upper Himalayas. But in this Shivalik region you will find I think many red spots are there. Actually this has been assessed through some formulation, and I think this shows that there may be very high excessive erosion in this region. So wherever we have the red spot, it means it's a very dangerous sign. Lot of erosion is taking place, and ultimately we are losing the natural resource, and that is the soil, which is the base for I think maybe for the agriculture and even for the civilization. Now here I think we have made some maps also for the soil loss tolerance limit. It is just to show that if they lose I think 2.5 tons per hectare per year of soil in the Himachal Pradesh, if it goes beyond that, I think it really is a severe problem. Maybe actually in the case of Haryana and Punjab on the plain area particularly, we may not have I think much of the problems. Now apart from the say soil, now we come to the water aspect. The average rainfall of the country is 1,197 millimeter, and total precipitation accounts for 4,000 billion cubic meters. And now you can just see here that 75% goes as actually runoff. Runoff is the excess water which is going from the catchment or from the watershed and going just out. Sometime actually it can be harvested, but if we don't harvest it properly, ultimately it's going to the rivers, and ultimately we lose it to the sea. Now if we look into the water availability actually in our country, per capita availability is quite low. It's 1,000 cubic meter per year per capita. As per the FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization, I think we are already under stress. But this gives, doesn't give a complete picture, because in some of the region we may have the excess water, but in some of the region we have got very meager water. And ultimately, this is just actually only an average value. We should not be, I think, confused. Now coming to the National Water Policy, They also say the main motto is to take up the basin or watershed level management strategies. Anyway, I am going to discuss further. If you look into the irrigated area, I think it's hardly 60% of the irrigation potential is being utilized. We may, I think, irrigate 140 million hectare, but I think hardly 80 million hectare land is being actually irrigated. And now this Ministry of Water Resources, I think they are also working at this aspect, that if they increase their water use efficiency by 10%, they can irrigate additional 14 million hectare land also. So I think water is the major concern, and I think the maximum water we are using in the field of agriculture. So this is the place actually where I think we have to save the water. And I think as per the Prime Minister's Krishi Sinchai Yojana scheme also, they also say that we should go for the more crop per drop, or for the per drop, we should have more crop. Means that we should increase water use efficiency. I think that is actually main motto, and I think that has to be done, I think, to save the water. I think this is the actually area where I think we can go for many micro irrigation schemes also. And I think there are many methods which can be actually taken up. So right now, the water use efficiency presently estimated to be only 35 to 40% for the canal irrigation. I think it's quite low. It is slightly better for the 60% for the groundwater irrigation schemes. Now coming to this agriculture aspect, it contributes to 21% of GDP, 11% of total export, and it gives employment to 57% of the workforce. It supports 600 million of people directly and indirectly. So I think this, I think resource, if we harvest that water and I think we retain the actual soil, certainly I think we can sustain this, the natural resources. Now people are now doing more water for the climate change. Now they say, if the 1 degree centigrade rise in temperature takes place, it might reduce the wheat yield by 4 to 5 million tons. So this is, I think, a big challenge we might be going to face in the future. Anyway, National Mission for Sustainable Agriculture is also there under this climate change and agriculture policy. They also say that watershed management is considered to be the most appropriate approach for the sustainable use and conservation of natural resources, ensuring sustainable use of all land resources. Now, and this actually, this philosophy actually has been adopted in most of the countries to reverse the degradation of the water in the soil resources. And I think many countries, I think, doing the work on this concept. That's very important. And watershed management is considered to be the most appropriate approach for the sustainable use and conservation of the natural resources. I think everything rests on the natural resources, which has to be conserved, which has to be sustained. We can use it for actually our present, and it has to be sustained, I think, for the future generation also. Now coming to the watershed concept, I think many of the engineers know it also, the people working in the civil engineering side, what is a kind of a watershed. Actually, generally it's an area over a given point that contributes to its runoff to the stream or a river which passes through a single outlet. I just give an example that in the villages, I think their ponds are there. And if you just I think come to know that this pond is getting water from at least about say 5 hectare catchment. It means from the 5 hectare land, the water is reaching to this pond. So we can say that watershed of that pond is 5 hectare. So it's only a concept which is being followed for many bigger watershed programs. The Department of Agriculture is taking the watershed of 500 hectare, maybe going up to 1000 hectare. But other departments, they are taking the watersheds with very large area also. Sometimes I think we take up the very large watershed and then we divide it with many sub watershed. So even I think any part of the region, I think, forms a part of the watershed, and ultimately the water is being drained into, I think, some pond and maybe some river, maybe some rivulet, maybe some river, and likewise. Now here I think we can understand it in a better way. You can just see, I think, some channels are there. And all these channels actually, if we select, I think this is the point for the outlet. So then all this water which we are getting from the rainfall, and then excess water, or you can say the runoff, is just flowing down with the slope in the stream and coming to actually this point. It means if we want to actually harvest the water at this point, maybe by gully plug, maybe by check dam, maybe by small earthen dam, maybe by masonry dam, meaning by any big dam, it depends upon the how much catchment or how much watershed we are taking up. So we can select out, okay, this is the point where I think all the water is going to come, excess water or the rainfall water, and then actually all the water will reach here to this point. So ultimately we have to account in how much the from how that water is coming from how much region, because we have to work out the quantity or the volume of the water, even the peak rate of discharge also. So that I think we can design the proper structure. It may be very small structure like pond, it may be small dam also, it may be bigger dam also, depending upon the area of the watershed which we select. So I think we should realize this point, that watershed is an area over a given point that contributes, it's a runoff to a stream or the river which passes through a single outlet. Suppose we want to make a check dam at this point, let's say at this point. So we just take the watershed or the catchment of only this region. You get it? If we select this point, then only this much water would be coming to this point. So that will be the watershed of for that structure or that pond, and likewise. Okay. Now generally we take out the topo sheets, and I think we can delineate with the help of the contour map. I think we get the watershed. We select out even through the streams also which are flowing down. We can select out what is the total catchment area or the watershed. And nowadays, actually, with the help of the satellite photographs, and I think we analyze them, and then I think we get the complete order of the streams, the first order, second order, or the third order, or fifth order, and ultimately we get the complete watershed, and we can delineate in this way. It means if we select actually this, this is one of the outlet. All this water, it means, is going to this outlet. And similarly, actually here also. Generally, I think in some of the experimental watersheds, we make this kind of structure. This is called the watershed gauging structure. And obviously, if you just see, I think that small housing, that the actually structure above the structure, and that is actually a small room is made, and where actually we are going to house that automatic stage level recorder. And through that automatic stage recorder, we get a complete hydrograph. We analyze that actually how much water has flown out from this outlet. So this gives us the quantity of the water. And when we actually analyze the hydrograph, we get the peak rate of discharge also. Anyway, these things are being connected at many points. And sometimes the land use of the watershed, maybe agriculture, maybe the forest, maybe the wasteland, and likewise. So we just then we try to analyze that how much water actually we are getting from the outlet. Maybe if the agriculture land is there, maybe we may get only 20% of the water, or we may get 30% of the water. In case we have got a very good forest, we can get about say 10% of water. If we get actually a scanty forest in the above catchment, we get actually hardly, maybe it may be increasing also, like say it might be only 20% or 30%. Sometimes actually even barren lands are there and a lot of water is being lost. So that way actually maybe it may be 50 or 60% also. Anyway. So we have to see that when we account for the water, and from the water we are getting from the watershed or the catchment. So if that watershed is untreated means it's a totally barren land. And again, actually no conservation measure has been taken up in the area. So what will happen? When the water is coming from the top, the soil will also come with the water, flowing water. And all this soil will settle down in the reservoir. And that's going to reduce the life of the reservoir. And once the capacity of the reservoir is reduced, ultimately we have the less command area. So this is, I think, very clear cut. I think you can say the relationship between the watershed and the command area. And if in the case that watershed is being treated, and treatment includes the soil and water conservation measures, maybe I think some vegetation measures. People say many go for the plantation. Is going to actually absorb more water in the soil, more infiltration will be there, more percolation will be there, and ultimately less runoff will be there, and that kind of thing. Or if that runoff is being sustained, at least they want to retain the soil. There are many structures by which the soil can be retained on the upstream, and we can get water which might be sediment free to a large extent. Suddenly, if this is the case, then we have the long life after the wire. That capacity will be maintained. And you will be surprising that many reservoirs have been made in the past, and whatever the design capacity was there, and I think it has reduced to very high limits. It might be varying from 10% to 90% also. They have lost the capacity of the reservoirs. It's not the case of only Shiva region, it's the case of many issue regions in the country. So ultimately, more capacity of the reservoir, and I think we have got a more command area. So ultimately, we come to this watershed management. It comprises preservation and maintenance of the land and water. Generally, the management of watershed project comprises the following activity. First point is that erosion has to be checked. That way, we are going to reclaim the degraded lands. And again, we control the quality of the runoff water. Secondly, we can reduce the damage by the floods and the sediment sediment deposits to the croplands and other important areas. Now then, to develop the water resource in the watershed, because this concept helps us, that how much water is available actually in the region, how much rainfall is there, and where, based on the various factors, we can find out, this much water actually can be stored in this watershed. So we can develop the water resource also. Now again, we have to improve the agriculture, grassland, forest land, and the wastelands. And even we go in for the livelihood activities also. Because our ultimate aim is to improve the quality of life of the human population living in the watershed by improving the infrastructure facilities and increasing the output from the land. Certainly, if you, we can retain the natural resources, it's going to help actually our agriculture and the grassland and the forest land and the wasteland. Even the wasteland can be reclaimed. They can also be put to the profitable use, and ultimately we are going to benefit the inhabitants in that region. We make actually the watershed management project, we delineate the watershed, we go for socio-economic survey, people participation I think has to be taken into account. We go to the villages, we ask them, what is actually your requirement? Because that requirement has to be fulfilled. We identify the problem, basic resources that we have so that we can account for that what kind of a plan we can make actually for the watershed management. We study the present use, we study the land capability classification. We go for the soil we go in for the soil health card. Then we propose a proper land use planning, soil and water conservation measures are being put up, water resource development is being taken up. Again, some special problem like landslide or landslips or other problems are there, how to control them. This strategy is also given. Now other components, we have to go on the productive side, that is agriculture, horticulture, forest and pasture. Because actually when we make this plan, it's not only the plan of the engineer or the forester or the economic person or the social science person. Actually, it is a combination of all. That's why we call it say, integrated watershed management. Actually, our establishment also, now we have the scientists from all the disciplines. They are from the economy, they are from soil science, they are from the engineering, they are from the forestry, they are from the social science also. It means we have to go take up an integrated approach to this watershed management project. We work out work estimate and everything anyway, it goes on, monitoring and evaluation and so on. So if we look into, this hill program, particularly in Shivalik, if you just see the hill slope like this, in the upper reaches, mostly at the forest area is there, we go for contour trenching, plantation of the grasses, maybe forest plantation, maybe small check dams, wherever we have these small rivulets. If you come to the middle beach, yes, we go for a series of check dams also. And then the farmers, they have the fields, they are going for terracing. Even nala bunding, horticulture crops they are taking up, agriculture crops they are taking in the terracing after doing the reclamation. And then in the low reaches, I think we have got more scope of the agriculture. I think we can just adopt contour bunding. We are going in for the agriculture crops, horticulture crops. Wherever I think we have to dispose of the excess water, we are going for the drop structure. And we can make the ponds, we can retain the water, and likewise. So if we just take up only the arable area, these are the kinds of conservation measures we are taking up. That it means in the agriculture area, contour in the field bending. Terracing is very common actually in the hilly areas. Sometimes we are putting up the weighted barrier only, just to so that the water may pass on, but the sediment may be retained and I think the farmer should not lose their fertile topsoil. Farm forestry, this is also being taken up. Outlet structures for disposing the excess water and the gully plugs and the shed lines. Like you can just see terraces. I think the farmers are very clever. So wherever they have gone for the collection on the slopes, they have gone for the making the terraces. I think the farmers have done it themselves. Sometimes department is also helping them. Sometimes in the watershed project, I think we are diverting lots of funds for the terracing work also. Many times they make the terraces, but due to short of money, sometimes they make it actually outward sloping. And when they make it outward sloping and the heavy rains are there, their terraces may be washed out also. So we advocate whenever the excess rain is there, you better take the actually this terraces, they should be inward sloping. And they should have a proper drainage system so that the excess water can be drained out and they should not have face any problem in the future. Here also you can just see typical farmland in hilly areas converted to terracing. Now actually in the hilly area also, I think we are advocating this kind of a strategy that okay, in the top reaches where the soil is not good, where mostly you have the gravelly soil, you can go in for the permanent plantation, that is the forest plantation, or maybe a combination of the some kind of horticulture plantation, maybe the robust or the hardy horticulture plantation. In the middle area, you can make the terraces. They can go in for the agriculture or in the combination with the say agroforestry. And wherever I think they have the excess water, they can harvest the water on the downstream, and I think this water can actually can be irrigated back or recycled back. Now coming to the water harvesting aspect, I think this is being followed in the plains also and in the hill region also. Region furrow sowing method. Actually, all the region furrows, I think they are being taken up on the contour line. Means actually, it means they should be across the slope. That's what we are taking up. It's going to retain a lot of water. I think I just given one data that whenever we have gone for the region furrow method, so actually in this you can just see the farmer practice, they are getting hardly 28 quintal per hectare. But when they go for the region furrow method, it's going to improve the moisture condition, and ultimately they are getting, I think, better yield. Anyway, this is the case of the rain-fed farming. Mulching also is being actually adopted nowadays at larger scale, and if we have sufficient mulching material, I think this can be actually taken up. It's going to actually retain the moisture for a longer time and helping the crops. Nowadays, actually, now this laser-assisted land leveling has come up. Now, if you just see, it gives us uniform water application, and about 25% of the irrigation water can be saved by this actually laser leveling. So, I think nowadays it's become very popular in the state like Punjab and Haryana, and they are, I think, taking up at a larger scale. State department schemes are also helping them. Raised bed planting also, I think, is also going to save 30-40% of the irrigation water. This actually, when we are going for the irrigated areas also, this also is quite helpful. Now coming to non-arable land, where the agriculture is not possible, where mostly the forest plantation is there, mostly actually in the hilly areas, although actually Punjab and Haryana doesn't have so much of the forest. But anyway, in the Himachal, I think a lot of forest area is there. So they are going for contour trenching, means that the trenches are being actually dug up across the slope, half moon basin kind of thing. Gully plugs, check dams, afforestation work is being taken up at a very large scale. It means a lot of plantation is being taken up. Then weighted barrier also, pasture development also, this also one of the kind of activity has been included. And then the other, any special problem, maybe it's a landslide or landslip, so all these complete strategy has to be given up for going for the soil and water conservation measures. Because when we take up the watershed in total, then actually in that way, the upper area might be having the forest area and lower area might be having the agriculture area. So in the agriculture area, I think we can go in for the soil conservation measures which are applicable for the arable lands. In the upper area, they should go in for the measures which are applicable to the non-arable lands. You can just see a contour tension in the hilly areas. Here you can see the brushwood check dams, brushwood checks, so that the soil should not slip from the top. They should not lose the actually soil in the non-arable land. Then on the down picture, you can see the gabion check dams, or you can say the crate wire type check dams are being constructed. water may pass on, but actually that sediment would be retained. Even nowadays, I think we are trying with the geojute also, wherever we have to face the problem of the landslide or the landslip, we are actually installing the geojute. And then finally, we go for the drainage line treatment. So here also, we are going for the gully stabilization through mechanical and vegetative measures. Steam bank protection by the crate wire walls, that is the gabion walls. Then we are constructing on the lower regions, village ponds, and the tank construction is being taken up. And the water harvesting structure means any kind of structure, maybe earthen or the masonry, they are being taken up to, I think, harvest the water. As I think earlier I told you, I think in Shivali foothills, we have the problem of the torrential erosion also. You could work out the area, yeah, how much area is under the torrents, and actually how much actually the area being actually degraded by the torrential erosion in the Shivalik area. Here I think you can just see some bioengineering technology. Actually what we see that if you go in for the crate wire structure throughout the side of the nala or throughout the side of the river, I think it's a very costly affair. So we advocate that it should be a combination of the crate wire structure, and at the same time we should take the help of the vegetation also. So here I think you can just see some of the pictures where I think we have gone in for the crate wire spurs, we call it spurs. They actually deflect the water of the torrent or water of the river to the center, so that actually our banks of the agriculture fields on the side by, they are not cut up, they are not cut, and they are not spoiled. And ultimately actually if we go in for this kind of strategy, I think we are going to save a lot of money. Excuse me. But anyway, this problem is common mostly in the Shivalik hills, Shivalik foothills rather. Sometimes we are taking the geojute also, and in some of the areas where we cannot go for these spurs because we don't have the big boulders and all. So what we have tried that, okay, you collect the debris in that area, just put it inside the empty cement bags, and put a very lean mixture of cement, and there becomes a kind of cutter spur. And again, they can be arranged in proper fashion, then covered with the wire and all, and I think it can also become a spur. Now coming to this water resource development site, rainwater harvesting. Now this is one of the data that 24 million hectometer potential is there in the country, and if we harvest this, we can get additional 60 to 65 million tons of food gas, which can be obtained by this potential. I think a lot of work has been done on the rainwater harvesting in many of the areas, and nowadays I think in the Prime Minister KCHI scheme also, a lot of work has been taken up to construct the ponds, renovate the old ponds, even I think renovate the say old reservoirs, very big reservoirs also, the silting being taken up, and many works have been done under those schemes. Now here are some examples in the Shivalik area for this participatory watershed management. Why we call it participatory? Because we feel that if you go and work in the villages in the field of watershed management, ultimately we have to look into the requirement of the beneficiary, of the requirement of the farmers or the inhabitants, what they exactly need, and based on that only we should make the complete watershed management plan. So here I think we have got very good examples like the Sukhumajri watershed, Bunga watershed, they are both in Haryana. Then we have the Railmaja watershed, that is actually in Punjab. Then we have the Mandala and Jolapur watershed, actually they are actually in Himachal Pradesh. So I have brought here some of the examples that what kind of work has been done actually in these catchments or in the watersheds, and how they have been beneficial. Now I think I'll just give you a very small story about Sukhna Lake. This lake was constructed in 1956. And after 10 years, I think 65% capacity was lost. It was lost because all the silt from its watershed or the catchment, 4200 hectare, it mostly came down. And due to siltation, the capacity of this Sukhna lake was lost to the extent of 65% just in 10 years. water spread was also went down. And I think government also, I think, utilized a lot of money for dry excavation and the wet dredging in that lake. And I think utilized and invested a lot of money also for that. So they thought actually this work I should take up, I think, every year, means a dissertation. Then only this problem can be solved. Now, Sukla Lake has one problem actually, that whatever sediment is coming from that catchment of 4200 hectare, and mostly it is Shivalik Hills. They are very fragile. They are mostly mitti ke pahad khade hain. So most of the soil actually just comes down. So actually permanent cure has to be taken up. From wherever the problem is starting, I think if it is actually taken care of there itself, then actually this Sukla Lake can be actually maintained properly for a long time. So a team of the scientists from the center actually has gone to that complete watershed of the Sukla Lake. They visited all the area and they could find out that from one of the village that was Sukhamajri, I think the maximum sediment yield was just coming down. So that point was actually spotted, and a kind of a watershed management works were taken up actually in that area. And mostly it was the work of the soil and water conservation and the plantation which were taken up in that actually Sukhamajri village and its land on the upstream side. But there was a very acute problem that whatever strategy were taken up, they were totally flawed. And the reason was, the farmers or the inhabitants, they did not support the complete scheme. They thought that actually these people are doing the work to save the lake, the Sukla Lake only. They are not doing the work for actually that village. Ultimately, they had a meeting actually in the evening with all the villagers, their team of the scientists, and they could find out that okay, they said that first villager told, first I think you fulfill actually our requirements, then only I think we can help you. So the scientist team asked them, okay, what are the actual problems you have in your region? And they replied that we have the complete rain-fed farming. It's all rain-fed area. We don't have any water resource. If the rains are good, we get the crop. If rains are not good, or some actually erratic rainfall is there, ultimately we don't get any proper yield from the fields. So they told, okay, you create some water resource, and then actually whatever you say, then we'll follow it. The department has gone for the plantation of the trees. It was all spoiled because all those animals were moving out in that area. So that was actually, I think, the thing started. And it was thought that until we involve the local person, actually our local villagers in the program, this program cannot be success. And I think that was the first start of the participatory watershed management actually in Sukhamajri village. And that was the first lesson actually we got from the Sukhamajri watershed program. You can just see here, I think this was one of the structures which are made having catchment of 9.2 hectare. Capacity was 5.6 meter and the command area was 20 hectare. If you just see the equation, catchment is hardly 9.2, but the command area is 20 hectare. So all this water they were getting actually in the monsoon season only. But if this water is properly retained, I think this is going to serve actually purpose for their actually future rabi crop also. So that was the kind of study which was followed there, actually in the Sukhamajri watershed. And suddenly they thought that we don't have high quantity of water, very, very heavy quantity of water. They cannot give 7 to 8 irrigation also. So they thought we can give say only 1 or 2 irrigation or 2 to 3 irrigation. We call it supplemental irrigation. So that kind of study was adopted, and actually complete underground pipeline system was given to that actually feed their fields, and this actually water was utilized by them. And that was, I think, the first very good start of the participatory watershed management. And we just see, I think, the water was applied on charge basis, and because society was made, and then actually the society was charging the money also for that on the hour basis or on the area basis. And I think wheat yield initially, which they were having 10 quintal per hectare, it went up to say 40 quintal per hectare also in that area. So that was actually the major success which this institute got in the Sukhumvit watershed in 1970s, 80s. So that was the thing actually. Now, whatever actually strategy was given, like say construction of the gully bluffs, construction of the check dams, construction of the ponds, construction of the many say silt retention structures, then the plantation, you know, in whole of the say 4200 hectare Sukhna catchment, the sediment yield was checked. Earlier, I think I have given figure of say 141 tons per hectare per year. It was actually a major quantity. It went down to 10 tons per hectare per year. Although we have a problem today also, because this 10 tons per hectare per year is going all the time, means every year, and it's getting accumulated. So certainly we have the problem after two to three years. Because all this silt is being accumulated by the lake only. It's not going to some other outlet or to the some other stream. That is actually main issue. But if we just see that figure from 141 tons per hectare per year to, it came down to 10 tons per hectare per year. The strategy was given and all the works were done by the UT Forest Department and Haryana and Punjab Forest Department. So anyway, they could follow that irrigation, one or two irrigation also. So we can actually see when the farmer thinks over for the sowing of the crop. Now he wants that actually soil moisture should be good in the field. And if he doesn't have actually too well or any other good resource, and they have to rest actually depend upon this very meager water. But if one irrigation is given, actually he can go in for timely sowing of the crop. If the sowing of the crop is delayed, ultimately he losing actually his crop yield also in further progress. So if one irrigation is given, I think he being benefited. Two irrigations are being given, I think he much more benefited, because there are some critical stages of the wheat crop where I think it needs more irrigation. So if the farmer can get 2 to 3 irrigation, they can really do wonder and they can get actually much better crop. I'm just talking about the rainfed region only. Wherever you have the irrigated, no problem. But there also in the irrigated area, that I think water should not be wasted. It should be utilized, I think, by many other measures. I think I have told you also earlier. So here also you can see, without any irrigation, I think they have gone for actually, it's hardly 7 quintal. But they have gone for 2 irrigation at the stage of pre-sowing and CRI. They got say 34 quintal. So it means if we collect, harvest the water in the small tank also, the farmer can give after 1 or 2 or 3 irrigation and after they can get a very good crop. So this is the case actually for the most of the rainfed areas, and where there actually after water harvesting becomes very important, and particularly in Shivalik region, I think it is very important. So there were many, I think, impacts of this Sukhumvit watershed interventions. Denuded catchment were covered with the grasses and the tree within a period of 10 to 15 years. Crop yield increased from 7 to 8 quintal to 35 quintal or 40 quintal. Grass production also increased. So if you just see, I think even the cattle composition also changed. I think I've got one more data here. Yeah. So if you just see the cattle population also, initially they were having mostly goats. But now they are having the buffaloes. And they got now that much better milk yield. They have the sufficient milk yield, and even they are selling to these urban areas, even to Chandigarh. Their per hectare income also increased manifold. Crop yield also increased, fodder yield also increased. So actually, they are some of the indicators which shows that there was a progress in the village. There are many more other indicators are there, but I am just talking about very few, 2 to 3 only. Crop yield increase, fodder yield increase, per hectare income increase. That's a very important issue. Cattle population increase means particularly for the buffalo and all, number of goats came down, and then milk yield also I think was increased. So they were actually, I think there was just a work done in 1970s, 80s, long back in the Haryana state, in the Sukhumvit watershed. And I think we got many good points from this watershed. People participation must be ensured in natural resource conservation and watershed management programs. Unless a project is aimed at meeting their needs, solving their problems, and mitigating their hardship, the same may not succeed. Constitution of village society, or the hill resource management society in this case, in Shivalik, must be a prerequisite for taking up such projects. They should formulate a society. They can have their own president, or the vice president, and the treasurer. They can actually operate the funds also. And what we do actually, whenever they start the work in the watershed program, they about 5 to 10% money is being deposited in the watershed development fund. This fund is retained with them only, so that actually after that State Department or other agencies, they leave the project after 4 or 5 years. It is this money should be retained for repair of the. Any other intervention which has been taken up in the watersheds. And the emphasis should be on sustainability, equity. All common property resources must be equitably distributed among all the stakeholders. And once the benefits from the project start accruing, the people are willing to take up the responsibility of protecting the forest. This is also actually happening. In Sukumari area, from that 9.2 hectare land, from where they were getting the water actually in the major pond, they were convinced that if you leave that your animals in the beginning in that area, and whatever plantation has been taken up, that will be totally spoiled. And then further, I think all the sediment will also come down, and then that reservoir will be silted up within 10 to 15 years, totally. So farmers also realize, okay, we will not leave our animals in the catchment of that pond or catchment of that reservoir. So that was a kind of social fencing also, which was actually adopted in this Sukumaji watershed. Likewise, I think many work can be taken up by UT Chandigarh Forest also, and Haryana Forest Department, and even Punjab also. Many structures have been made in the Sukna Lake catchment, and I think a lot of work has been done. Sediment yield has come down, but it's anyway, it's getting accumulated in the year by year. Now coming to other Varma watershed, we have this Rail Maja watershed. This is actually in Punjab. I will not show the detail. I've just show, I think, one of the water resource structure. Catchment was about 60 hectare. Capacity was 13.7 hectometer. And the command area was 25 hectare. Again, this is the work done in the rainfed areas so that the farmer can get at least 2 to 3 irrigation. And I think the production can increase. This is what it should be seen in the tables also. Even I think we have taken some basic indicators, crop yield, fodder yields, number of bullocks, number of actually this buffaloes or cows, and even the milk yield, and likewise. One more project we have, this Bunga watershed. And I tell you, actually, these projects are being taken up by this institute just to make a kind of a model integrated watershed management project. So that the State Department functionaries and other NGOs and other actually central government department officers, they should come and see the work, how the work has been done. And I think the technology should be propagated. And this is actually line of work we should be adopted in most of the region. And I think Government of India actually certainly at that time I think has adopted this Sukumaji watershed in 70s, 80s, even after 90s also. And I think about 250 projects have been taken up in the Haryana, Punjab, Himachal, even in J&K also, based on the Sukumaji project. So here actually in this case of Bunga watershed, catchment was very high. It's about 155 hectare. I think very big dam has been constructed, about 60 meter height, earthen dam. And I think the command area initially is about 200 hectare. But again, I think it was just only for 1 or 2 irrigation. And I think in that area, that wheat yield and fodder yield, everything was actually increased. You can just see some of the impacts here. And I think I just tell you on one point, there actually annual income, actually it was increased by 86% in that area. Now, recently, I think we started this kind of work also. We say that our ancestors, they were very clever. And actually, in every village, we used to have, I think, two to three ponds, even 1 or 2 ponds in that area. But most of the ponds, they are being, I think, they are silted up. And secondly, in many cases, I said their catchment is lying different. Jahan se pani aata hai, wahan kisi ne ki ghar bana liya hai, kisi ne phir pani ko kahin mod diya hai, kisi ke khet ban gaye hai. अल्टीमेटली जो पानी खेत में तालाब में आना चाहिए वो पानी वहां नहीं आता है. तो सेडिमेंटेशन सिल्टेशन हो गया, कैपेसिटी कम हो गई. एंड एक्चुअली व्हेन दैट दे आर नॉट गेटिंग द सफिशिएंट कैचमेंट वाटर, सो दैट अगेन वाटर इज आल्सो गेटिंग रिड्यूस. सो आई थिंक दिस इज द केस. नाउ व्हाट इज रिक्वायरमेंट, आई थिंक वी शुड गो इन फॉर डिसिल्टिंग. दिस वर्क इज बीइंग टेकन अप नाउ डेज इन मनरेगा स्कीम ऑल्सो. आई थिंक लॉट ऑफ वर्क इज बीइंग डन टू रेनोवेट द ओल्ड पॉन्ड्स. Firstly, they go for the desilting, the pond and the reservoir. Then again, they should channelize the flow also. The catchment is lying different. I think the flow has to be channelized so that the water can reach to the pond. then the diversion of the flow from the other catchment to supplement the water yield. Anyway, this kind of work has been done in the hilly area only, but like say channelization of the flow of the catchment, this work has been done in the plain area. You can just see, I think down below two figures are there. These were actually initial, there were two ponds. They were mostly silted up. They were renovated by desilting. Now, whenever we go for desilting of the old ponds, the seepage rate increases. And that also becomes a kind of problem, that the water is not going to stand for a long time. What we advocated, okay, when you go to renovate the old ponds, in that case, whatever top soil is there in that pond bottom, that is very good soil. Actually, maybe 5 to 10 centimeter, depending on the depth and all. That soil actually should be excavated first. It should be kept at one side. And when we complete the complete desilting work, we might be increasing the depth to 2 or 3 or 4 meter. Again, this soil should be spread at the bottom. In that way, I think a lot of seepage can be checked, maybe in 1 or 2 years. So that study can be actually applied. Then secondly, after renovating of these ponds, we could find out that their self watershed or self catchment were very small. It means pond has been renovated, capacity has been increased, but they are not getting sufficient water. Now what has to be done? Now if you just see the second figure, what we did in that area, we have taken up a construction of a channel. It can be a construction of kacha channel, depending on the soil, or we might go in for pakka channel. So the water from the larger area can be sent to this pond. So ultimately, when we increase the catchment area or watershed area of the pond, so we will get more water. And I think this pond will be full. And whatever scheme we make for irrigation, particularly in these small areas, I think that will be our success. Here, I think you can see some of the data from this actually area, in this Jodhpur project. It was in the down below hilly region. It was in the down hills only. The water storage capacity of the pond was raised from 1 hectometer to 2.4 hectometer. Area contributing runoff to the ponds, it was initially 2.5 hectares only. It means these ponds were getting water only from 2.5 hectare catchment or the watershed. That has been increased to 8.5. So ultimately, we will get more water because now we have the larger catchment. And the area covered under supplemental irrigation, I think it was initially nil. Now it is usually 8 hectares. So sometimes these small schemes also can also help the farmers. They can do it actually on their own fields also. This can be done. If they make a kind of pond, they harvest the water, collect the water, and it can be recycled back. You can just see the maize yield, quintal per hectare. Initially it was 12 quintal per hectare. It went up to 27 quintal per hectare. And I think in coming years, it might have increased further also. Yeah, similarly, the wheat also we can see. Now here also you can just see the strand of wheat crop in that same area. It was about 33 quintal. Now again, I say because this water we can harvest only in the monsoon season. We are not getting actually any subsurface flow and all. So ultimately, this water has to be utilized very judiciously. And only maybe 2 to 3 irrigation can be given, not more. And at the same time, I think the farmers, I think in that area, they are actually cultivating this, they are having the fish culture also. Certainly, we can go in for the multi-purpose use of the water harvesting structures. That's what you can see here. One more thing, I just tell you, of a Mandala watershed, I think one project. Here the watershed of the catchment was hardly 4.32 hectare, from where this pond was getting the water, but its capacity was hardly 0.7 hectare meter. Again, this pond, they have gone for desilting initially. And they increased the capacity to 2 hectare meter. And you are surprised that this 2 hectare meter water was actually giving the water to about 10 hectare land. So about the 6 hectare area was being actually irrigated by the lift irrigation. And 4 hectare area, I think they were having the irrigation by the gravity. It was going with the pipelines. Now, because initially we thought, okay, the rainfall is about 1000 millimeter, let's say rainfall is 1 meter from actually this 4 hectare land. You might be getting only 100 to 80 meter of water with a very highly sloping area. You might get a runoff to 25%. So we accounted for 2 hectometer of water. But we thought in some cases there may be the chances that there may be low rainfall, or there may be only hardly 50% rainfall, there may be drought. Then what will happen to this pond? So whatever scheme has been made, this won't be sustainable. So there was one more catchment just by side by, and all this water was just going waste. A check dam has been constructed. This one. And one pipe was taken from this check dam by the cool to this actually pond. So whenever actually low, low rainfall is there, or the drought is there, at least the water can be diverted from the adjacent catchment or the adjacent watershed, and this water can be sent to the main pond. Because this is a very old pond, you cannot shift it. So ultimately, this water actually, you can supplement the water. Nowadays, they are talking about the Sukhna Lake also. Water shortage there, water level is just going down. Now they are thinking of diverting the water from the adjacent catchment or from some other sources. That's what we are trying to. So here in this case, we wanted to make this a sustainable water source so that the scheme for irrigating the 10 hectare land should be successful. So this kind of study was done, made. Now the people talk about the climate change. So climate change also, I think this is one of the studies which has been taken up actually in that area. So then water can be diverted, and then we can have the sufficient water, whether rainfall is 50%, we don't mind. And our scheme will be successful. Here I think you can just see the pipeline, or the gravity pipeline is given actually. And they were charging, watershed committee were there. They were charging this distribution also. They were charging very high rate because they were utilizing the diesel pump and the strand and all this water was supplied to the underground pipeline system. That was the thing taken up by the farmers. So here also we got a lot of success. Crop yield increased to 3-4 times. Initially they were given, there were 151 farmers in the whole of the watershed. 151, I am telling for the about say 425 hectare watershed. Only one scheme I have shown for the water resource development. There were other schemes also. So soil health card was distributed to 151 farmers, and this was the case in the year 2002. Now Government of India has also realized, and as most of the governments, state government also, that they are distributing the soil health card to their farmers. This work has been taken up at a very large scale by all the states. Gujarat was the first state which has taken up the work. But now I think we are seeing a lot of work being done by the Haryana, Punjab and Himachal also. This is just educating them how much actually, what is the potential of their land, how much nitrogen they have, how much phosphorus they have, how much potash they have, and that the proper recommendations are being given up for the major crop particularly. So this is, I think I have already shown the climate resilient strategies also. People talk a lot about the climate change, how we can adapt it, how we can mitigate the climate change. I think whatever soil conservation work and the water harvesting work, this I think all relates to the climate resilient strategies. In the lower hills, I think we got some scope of the subsurface water harvesting also. I think this is also there. In many cases, they get a kind of spring or the jharna, and I think they can have a lot of water in the tanks. And this also I think they are using for the irrigation. In Shivalik foothills, some subsurface dams are also constructed. Actually, these nala or the torrents, which are coming from the hilly region, they have a lot of water during the monsoon. But after the monsoon, actually, you will find, I think, most of the actually streams or the nalas, they are dry. But many a times, the underneath current of the water flows actually in the nalas. So these, you can just see, I think this is a kind of dam constructed underground. If you just see this figure, this is the top level of the nala. Here you can just see, I think the underground structure is made, this cemented wall. And then actually, this is the kind of actually storage area, which is throughout the width of the nala, or the throughout the width of the river. It extends. So a lot of water is being actually accumulated at this point throughout the length, throughout the width of the nala. And you can see here, there's a filter here has been made through these small pipes. The water is coming to this actually, you can say, kind of stand throughout the width of the nala. Lot of water is there actually, and through this pipe, they're just conveying the water through gravity on the downstream side. But if this kind of structure is made at a higher elevation, the water can be sent by gravity also very easily, because in these hilly areas, most of the fields are actually at the higher side of the area, higher side of the hills, and their nalas or the actual rivers, they are at the bottom. So if this kind of structure is constructed at a higher elevation, again you can take this water with the pipes, RCC pipe or the PVC pipes, and when this pipe goes actually at the bottom also, this water will automatically will go up to the fields, because actually this water is coming from the a higher elevation through gravity. So I think we're going for the farmer's evaluation also, that what kind of work they like in the watershed management project. Anyway, water is the main concern. They were more liking for the water resource development. Now, we have the scheme going on, more crop per drop, water efficiency has to be increased. Either we go for supplementary irrigation or we can go for micro irrigation. Now, increasing water efficiency, I think that's very important. It should be increased by at least 10% or to 20%. Conservation tillage nowadays is very common. Micro irrigation, it says water by 40 to 70% of water is being saved, 30% of fertilizer, increase of 20 to 100% of the crop yield also. Then ledge and land leveling, I have shown you earlier, 25% of the irrigation water can be saved. And now the zero tillage is also coming up. Punjab Agricultural University, they have made the machine for the zero tillage also. So now they actually, again, 5 to 25% of the irrigation water can be saved. There are some of the actually overall efficiencies. If you go in for the surface irrigation, 30 to 35% irrigation efficiency, it means a lot of water is wasted. If you go for a sprinkler, 50 to 60% efficiency you can avail. And but once you go for drip irrigation, though it has got many limitations also, you can go for 80 to 90% of the efficiency. That's actually, I think, being advocated. So nowadays, micro irrigation is also being very much advocated, particularly in the rainfed regions, in the watershed programs. Supplementary irrigation, I think earlier also I have told you, because the whatever water they collect in the monsoon season, it may not be sufficient for the wheat crop for 7 to 8 irrigation. So ultimately, 2 to 3 irrigation can suffice the work. And certainly, if you just see as one of the example, the 63% water efficiency, if you compare to conventional system, where we give 7 to 8 irrigation, or if we give only 2 to 3 irrigation, at least 63% much more efficiency is achieved. Nowadays, people are talking about the multiple use of the harvested water. I think one example I have shown you also, they have gone for fisheries. In some of the projects, they are combining each and everything, like crop integrated with the fish, poultry, piggery, water mills. Anyway, water mills, they are more common actually in the hilly region only. Suppose the water mills are there at the top of the hill. The water is just coming down. Even the wheat flour is also mixed up to some extent in that water. And this becomes a kind of a fish feed also at the bottom in the ponds. Nowadays, people are talking about this also, rooftop water harvesting. So this also has become a very major component in the watershed management program. This is also being taken up. So I think proper dimensions are being given, facilitation tank and filtration unit and all. And this is being, I think, advocated in all these rainfed areas particularly. And now actually, if you find even in Chennai and even in the Bombay also, even in Panchkula also, I think, now they are advocating, if you are going to build up a house in one canal, actually land, I think this route of water harvesting compulsory. Again, as I told you earlier, that we are taking up we are going following an integrated approach. Even the forest officers are also with us. They are going for afforestation work, plantation of bamboo actually in the nalas or actually the chows in this area. Wherever we work, actually, we farm. I think we educate the farmers to make a nursery. We help them at the initial stage, and whatever I think plants they develop, we take up actually in the watershed program. So they also get benefited. Farm forestry, I think also this is also being educated. The poplar and the eucalyptus plantation. Amla plantation, I think this area is fetching very good price. Amla, we go in for actually better quality, budding of amla, mango orchards, even peach. Peach is also coming up very well in this region. Here in Panchkula, I think we are getting a lot of money, I think from the peach also. Just in one hectare farm actually, which is located in Panchkula only, very close to Mata Devi temple. There I think actually we are getting about 5 lakhs rupees per hectare in the peach only. You can just see some of the, I think, very good crop of the peach. So this can grow up actually, mostly it is going up in the, say, Himachal only. But in the plains area also, I think it's coming up very well. There are certain varieties. Like, so this is a variety called, say, Shari Punjab. This has been actually given by the Punjab Agriculture University. Organic farming. Nowadays, people are advocating for the organic farming also. Javi Kheti. Like this vermicompost pit. The kechi hote hain khad jo banate hain. So this is, you can see one example for the, I think, pakka, actually shed. Even I think the villages, they can go for actually kacha shed also. In this way actually they can have this vermi shed or the vermi composting. Apart from that, they can go for other methods for composting also. With this native composting or generic composting and likewise. Now, in the integrated program, we take up the trainings also for the women. In that case actually, a lot of trainings are being given to the women in the villages. Sometimes preparation of the mango pickle, training on the lemon and tomato preservation, preparation of the apple jam, or maybe other seasonal vegetables. Even they open up a school also, training on tailoring and embroidery, demonstration of jam jelly making. So all these kind of works are being done. Even the home science person, one lady also there with us. Here you can see also, they are making soft ties in the villages. So that way, watershed program is a multi-phase program. Means many aspects are involved actually in this watershed program. So to sum up, I think in India, many watershed programs are going on. I think this is one of the data generated by the ICRISET, that is International Institute. The increase in the crop yield is by 25 to 40%. But in some area, it is very high. Some area, it may be low also. On an average, it is 25 to 40%, even in the dry land farming. A reduction of soil loss by 30%. Impact of water resource development has been more pronounced. Actually, we have seen that in most of the watershed, wherever we have got for water resource development, that project is highly successful. Because what farmer wants, he wants that water resource should be generated. If you give him water, rest all the works can be done by him. Because when you work in the watershed program, and the water is being sold by the watershed society, right? If the water resource is generated, and actually when the farmer has to irrigate, he knows that if his field is not properly leveled, he's going to invest more time in irrigation. And he has to pay more also for the water. So just create the water resource, and rest all the things can be done by the farmer himself. He can go for leveling terracing, improving his fields, so that he should not actually invest more money. Large increase in the vegetation cover of the barren hill slope. Yes, this has been a major achievement. Long tracts of marginal lands brought under dryland horticulture. Development of agri-horti and agri-forestry systems. Regeneration of the grassland for more water in the grass. And certainly it can lead to the sustainable agriculture and strengthen the area to face a climatic vagaries or changes taking place in the present time. So I think, as I told you earlier, all the soil and water conservation work, particularly water harvesting work and all, it can certainly face the climate change. So these are the actually strategies we should be following. We always talk about the climate change, adaptation, mitigation. So I think some of the strategies I have shown also in the watershed management program. So that's all actually, I think, from my side. Now I think I will invite some questions from the centers. Chetan.
cities.
So thank you so much, Dr. Tiwari, for giving us such a illuminating talk on watershed management, its significant aspects and prospects also, and the case studies related to the success stories and the actual work being taken up in this particular area. I am really grateful to you, sir. Now the house is open for question answer session. So I request the participants from various centers to kindly ask a question. You should go.
Sky
Kurukshetra. Yes, please. Any questions from Kurukshetra's side? Engineering technology?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
Now we move to?
It's
Bharatpur. Government Polytechnic Bharatpur. Shri Gopal Verma, Government Polytechnic. Yes, please. Any question from Institute at Bharatpur?
No, ma'am. No questions, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. And then you ask the caller.
Yes, we have a question.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
I want to know actually about the what are the organization dealing with watershed management and what government stands for watershed management.
Okay.
चल रहा
है. Okay, I got a question. Actually, Government of India is giving lots of programs for the watershed development. Watershed management programs are there. Now, I tell you, whatever watershed actually I have shown, that just the model watershed program which we have taken up actually in this area. Apart from that, Government of India has a very large scheme for the watershed development. In this way, I think a lot of money has been given to state departments to take up the watersheds. Actually all the states are following up this watershed program. The Department of Agriculture, Department of Soil and Water Conservation, wherever they have, and even the Department of Forest, and even the Department of the, say, Water Resource Development also, or the Irrigation Department, they are also taking up the watershed management program. So there are the several agencies dealing with this, and apart from that, even the NGOs also, non-government organization, they are having this watershed program. Now again, now recently that scheme has come, Prime Minister Krishi Sinchai Yojana, PMKSY. So under that also, this is one of the component of the watershed management. So this can be taken up by, say, any agency, particularly who are dealing with the natural resource management. And certainly the Department of Agriculture, or Department of the Rural Development, they are, I think, more responsible and they are taking up these works at a very large scale.
Any other question? Sir, my second question is, what are the alpha-alpha walls?
Okay. Wherever actually initially, what they have done, they have gone for the underground pipeline system. Now, wherever actually they want to open up the water actually in the, say, farmer's field, they are putting up this alpha-alpha wall. The alpha-alpha wall, actually, this can be open up from the top. They have the water which actually going on the sides, and certainly coming to one of the drain, right? And that way then actually it can be closed also whenever the water need is not there. So this simple actually kind of wall which is just, I think, being utilized at the farmer's field to drain out the water from the pipeline.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Any question from our participant at CTV studio? Yes, please. And one of the core center is there. From Jaipur. Jaipur. Yes, please. From Jaipur. Engineering College.
Hello.
No
question, sir. Thanks.
No question. Any question from our participants?
But this is already rainfall, as you described earlier, the encroachment in the bay of water to the ground. So, what we are doing there is we need a water body for the
in summers we fill it by tube wells also.
Okay.
This is the way we are building.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm.
So instead of the sustainability, mm-hmm. we are just using the groundwater.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
This is the way.
I got it actually. I tell you, because this particular Narega scheme, I think, if they go in for the lot of big earthwork, they can generate some more ponds also. Now, apart from that, actually, that the catchment is lying different, the water is not coming to the pond. That's also one of the issues. So, it depends upon the selection of that pond, selection of that area, where you are going to construct the pond. So, whenever we go to the villages, we have them, ask them, wherever you have the low-lying land. Then you can expect, yes, you will get the water at that point. But suppose you have the actually pond, small pond at one point, which is slightly at the higher status. Certainly, I think there will be a problem.
Actually, they are
in
long, long
ago. Yes, okay. Uh-huh.
But today, encroachment is over there.
Yeah, that's actually, yeah, that's a very common problem everywhere. Yeah, yeah, that's a very common problem.
That's why they are
going to die. But still, I think maybe, it depends anyway, it depends on many factors in the area also. But suppose they can divert the water from at some point, they can do it. That's what you're doing also, from two ways. But actually, if we can get some natural resource, I think they'll be much better. Yeah, 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 exactly. Yeah, yeah, certainly. Yeah, I tell you, even regarding this groundwater also, you know the situation in Punjab and Haryana. 75% of the area is grey in Punjab. A similar case actually here also in Haryana, 50%. And most of the irrigation is being done by the city well only. Punjab irrigation only hardly 27% is being done by the canals. Rest all by groundwater, pretty well. In Haryana also, only 50% by irrigation, in the irrigation canal. Rest all India by, I think, two wells only. So we are actually. सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट बोर्ड जो है पर्टिकुलरली दिया रखे और देखिए गवर्नमेंट रिचार्ज तो उसपे वो रिचार्ज शेफ वगैरह लगा रहे हैं मतलब वेरी कॉस्टली वहाँ प्रॉब्लम आता है सरफेस वाटर का अच्छा है इस वक्त हमने तालाब बनाइए इस चेकडे बनाइए नाले आपके बह के जा रहे हैं उनमें चेकडे बनाइए तो पानी कम से कम एंट्री है कि इनको इन साइड द सॉइल स्टेटा इन्फिल्ट्रेशन पर्कुलेशन डीप पर्कुलेशन इन दिस वाटर माइट बी अवेलेबल इन द ओपन वेल्स एटलीस्ट
The result in our
place
is
the
groundwater quality is going
to be pretty much. That is a big problem, big issue. Yeah, very good.
Thank you.
So, on behalf of participants and Department of Electrical Engineering, I thank Dr. Tiwari for sparing his valuable time and enriching us with his talk regarding watershed management, its various aspects, successful case studies, and the various technologies which are being employed for conserving of soil and water. Thank you so much, sir. And we will meet after lunch at after an hour. And for the there is some change in the timetable due to engagement of Dr. Babban Kumar. He will not be taking the session. Instead of him, we are going to have a talk from Mr. Diman. He is working in the field of eco-friendly building material technique. So he will be delivering the talk on how hollow brick blocks making for building the house. How it saves the energy, how it saves the cost also. That is, it is very good for insulation also because it is a hollow and it is less costly also and easy to make at the site also. So for that practical work he is doing in the field. So afternoon, after an hour, we'll meet again and we'll have a talk from Mr. Diman. And tomorrow morning, Dr. Babban will take the lecture. technology for food and water quality. Thank you so much. So I'm a fan in my
अगर आप